I still remember I was having my dog. I was walking with my dog and it was raining, and then Tommy calls me and I'm like, now I have a bad feeling, and I answer him, what the fuck? What? And he was like, how you know this is bad? I'm like, now I have a feeling, tell me. Yeah, KALMA just called me and he said that he will leave the band. I'm like, oh my god. And I was like, I think I was, I quit smoking like, I don't know, half a year before that phone call, but somehow I had some cigarettes on my, you know, on my jacket when I was out with my dog, and I light up the one cigarette immediately. I'm like, okay, fuck that. Yeah. That's bad. And then I called KALMA, of course. I'm like, dude, what the fuck?
Following the conclusion of the Monsterkin Dream, and with the departure of Enery on keyboards, LORDI set out into a new cycle for the Arockalypse era. But one more departure would follow. That's where we start today as we discuss the Arockalypse. From True Metal Podcast, I'm Matthew Kessie. And this is Monsters of Rock, The LORDI Story. And you're listening to Episode 5, The Arockalypse.
Was that decision then at that time for you to leave LORDI just before the release of The Arockalypse? Was that an easy decision for you to make?
Absolutely not. Right. It wasn't easy. Although, in the same time, it kind of was, because I had four kids at that time, and no one of them was in school already. So my oldest one was six, and
yeah,
my youngest one was just born, and we had lots of family stuff going on back then. And then of course I didn't see, you know, any bright future with LORDI.
Yeah.
Because we had already struggled, not all the time, but almost struggled for 3 years, and we have, you have to be honest, we didn't get so much money out of that.
Yeah.
On that era, that the money, or I don't know what kind of money, but some kind of money came after the Eurovision success,
yeah,
and the Arockalypse album success, but and that was really time consuming, and we had a couple of long tours, and I had an opportunity to do it, but I still decided that it's best that I'm not part of that anymore.
Yeah.
After informing the band of his decision to leave, KALMA would record all of the bass parts on the third LORDI album, The Arockalypse.
When I informed the band that I would leave, promised that we were already recording the album,
okay,
the Arockalypse album. So I promised the guys, and I really wanted to, you know, record the basses on that album, because I knew the songs and we had rehearsed them already. So I promised them to play on that album, and I'm glad that I did.
Yeah.
It was such a success.
While KALMA recorded the bass parts for the album, he would not feature on the cover, as this would eventually go to his replacement, much like when KALMA replaced Magnum on Get Heavy, LORDI's first album. KALMA's final concerts with the band would also take place in November of 2005 in Russia. These, of course, would actually be LORDI's first gigs in the country, and also AWA's first gigs with the band. AWA was, of course, LORDI's newest member at the time and the band's keyboardist. This is her journey into music.
I started, when I was 5, 6 years.
Right, okay.
I was 5 when I got the piano, and then I started the lessons. Maybe I had already turned 6. So let's say from 5 years old. I don't know, I just, piano was somehow very tempting to me. I mean, when I was picking the instruments, like which one I would like to play, I was sure that I want to play something, then piano was, I don't know, number one or second, because I also wanted to play harp. yeah, but my parents didn't think that. They were saying it's not so good idea, so then pick something else. Okay, then it's piano. Quite soon I saw keyboards, like 80s. When I was a child, it was 80s, and in the music, the keyboards were very, like synthesizers were very big thing and a kind of a new thing, and so I was fascinated by them. So maybe I was putting together, like, I mean, connecting piano and synthesizers, even if they are not the same, but
yeah,
quite close.
Our journey into music had progressed from keyboards to synthesizers, and it wouldn't be long after this that she would start playing in her first band.
Then when I was a teenager, I joined my first band. It was called Punaiset Messiat. Okay. It sounds, it's in Finnish, it's like Red Messiah.
Okay.
It was a punk band, kind of indie band. That was my first real band.
Awa and this band would then go on to record some albums together.
I was at least playing on 3 albums, but also that, like, Lordi, I joined Lordi later, not from the beginning. Mm. The same thing was with that band, that they had been already playing for a couple of years.
Fast forward to 2005, and with Lordi needing a keyboardist after the departure of Enery, Awa would soon find her way involved with them through a mutual contact between her own band and Lordi.
Manager at that time for Lordi, he was called Ari Tiainen, who also was the owner of the record company that this my first band was on in, how do you say? So I knew we were friends with Arska, the manager, for many years, and then I was watching one of his bands in some gig, and there Arska was with Kita, okay. Sampsa.
Yeah.
There, and then he introduced me to Sampsa, and then I don't know, maybe we connected a little bit, and then I said, oh, I would love to play keyboards in your band. If you ever have a position open, give me a call. And it was a little bit of a joke. I didn't know, and I didn't know that they already then were thinking to say to Enari that maybe she didn't fit in the band. So then I don't know, it took some months, and then Sampsa called me like, hey, do you remember me? And, and the rest is history. So it's good to, you know, open your mouth when you want to say, if you want something, it's better you say it out loud, because then it might happen.
You might think joining a band like Lordi would be intimidating at first, but it proved to be quite the opposite here. And this kind of seems to be the case a lot of the time with Lordi.
It was fun. I mean, they were nice guys. Maybe with Amen, it was me and Amen, we had since the beginning a little bit like a, you know, we didn't fight for real, but we had some like sister and brother fighting, okay. You know, but we were good friends and we still are. But I mean that maybe with him since the beginning, we had a little bit like, do I like this person or not? But then, of course, then we got to know each other better. And I don't know, they were, it's so long time ago.
Yeah.
I still remember that we met in a restaurant, and I remember Mr. Lordi having a dinner, and then for the dessert he took a chocolate cake, and I love chocolate, so I was like, okay, he's a nice guy, he's liking chocolate.
With Awa joining the band as the Countess on keys, Lordi would also find a replacement for KALMA in the Hellbull Ox. Unfortunately, while Ox was interviewed for the series, he declined to have our interview featured as part of the documentary. Therefore, at the end of this series of Monsters of Rock, the Lordi story, we'll upload the interview with Ox in full for you to listen to. Lordi entered the studio in 2005 to record the Arockalypse alongside producer Jerky Doyle. This album would feature numerous guest appearances, all of which were idols and influencers of Lordi. They range from Dee Snider and JJ French of Twisted Sister, Bruce Kulick, formerly of Kiss, and the German tank Udo Dirkschneider of Accept and UDO fame. However, there was one other guest in the works for this album.
There was one more.
Was there? Okay.
Yeah, there was one more. Sebastian Bach.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, but he's a character. He's
yeah, he's always known to be one.
He's a fuck. I mean, he's so cool. But I mean, he's a force of nature. He is
follows his own rules.
Yeah, he promised to do it.
Right.
And he said he'll do it, and he wanted to do it, but he just has so much energy and enthusiasm in him that it's like it just didn't happen within the time frame.
Right.
And it's like, I mean, we were so it was so fucking funny when it's like we met him at some festivals or something. Before the Arockalypse album recordings or something, and you know, we became, you know, I mean, he digged the band. He was really into Lordi, and you yeah. can even see that it was one of those big deals when you saw his DVD that came out later, that he was wearing a Lordi shirt on that DVD, and we were like, whoa, yeah. motherfucker, goddamn, and it's like. And I emailed him so many times and all that. He's yeah, fuck on, yeah, fire it up, dude. Let's do it, yoo-hoo! And they're like, all right, here's the thing. So we need you to do this and that. Yeah, I'm gonna do it. And then it's like you're waiting and nothing happens. And then you're like, dude, are you gonna do it? Yeah, I'm gonna do it. Fuck yeah, woo! And it's like then after a while. Becomes a longer while, and it comes a longer while, and you just keep asking, and he's like, "Yeah, I'm gonna do it. Fuck yeah!" And it's like, and it's nothing's happening, and then you realize that okay, he's one of those guys that it's like, who has so much energy. It's like dynamite that is lit up, but it's in a too small of a little container that is like exploding all the time. So yeah. there's like, so eventually it didn't happen yet. It might still happen because I'm pretty sure that he would still probably, you know, maybe he would want to do it again.
Yeah.
But the thing is that after a while, I stopped asking because I mean that, and then it was, I don't know how long afterwards it was, but then he contacted me and was like, "Hey, when are we going to do this thing?" I was like, "Well, the album is already in the stores, and you know, it it's already done. So I was asking for it for, I don't know, 10 months or something. But okay, let's see. Let's see another time. But yeah, so he was supposed to be there, and he really wanted to be, and we really wanted him to be there.
Yeah.
But then if somebody would ask what happened, I would say Sebastian Bach happened. You know?
The Arockalypse era, with its many lineup changes and numerous guest appearances, was also the first time that Lordi's A&R manager, Janne Halmkrona, became involved with the group. And since 2005, Janne has been the man that Lordi bounces ideas off and gets feedback on them. And I guess the best point for us to start really here with Janne is actually finding out what A&R does, as I'm sure that many of you possibly have heard it but not fully understood what that role actually means.
Well, it's actually changed now that I'm a freelancer, because when I started at Sony in 2005 and started working with Lordi right then. So it was it's kind of a bit different, because basically what I do with them is, well, actually what I do day to day, it's easy to start that. So what I do is first try to turn Tommy's head, because he has all these crazy ideas to make an album. So I'm trying to convince him to do it some other way, but he's very stubborn, and that's like throwing gasoline into the flames. Because I mean, that's exactly what he wants to do. Is what he wants to do, you know.
Okay.
So yeah, but basically what I do is first, when we start a project, we talk about what we're gonna do, what kind of album is coming, and where, in what studio, and who's gonna produce, and all the stuff like that. That's what we decide together, and I basically do all the like almost like a secretary. So in a way that I book the studios.
Once the studio is booked, Lordi then has to choose which songs will make it onto the album. A process which Janne says has evolved over the years.
It's changed a bit how we choose the songs. We used to have this kind of poll, but that way everybody listens to all the songs, all the demos, and then we like grade them, and what comes out of this really weird grading process, we decide then what we're gonna record to an album. And then we record maybe a couple of more songs, but like if the album requires 12 songs, we're gonna record 15 or 16 or 17 songs. And
okay,
then after that's done, then we decide together which songs are gonna be on the album. And I normally help Tommy with the running order of the songs, because I really like to do that. And Tommy is always, he has some kind of idea, but then he always asks for help for on that. And but nowadays on this last album, it's almost like Tommy writes the songs, and me and him choose, like we kind of do this preliminary selection of the songs together, and then the rest of the band comes maybe a bit later into the process, and so that they don't have to listen to all the 50 songs or 60 songs that okay. Tommy has. So it, because it's sometimes we had like really like almost like 100 songs to choose from. Yeah. And
Janne's role also extends to the scheduling side of Lordi, which he tells me can be painfully difficult with this band.
Lordi is the most difficult. It's always. It's because Tommy is very optimistic about his schedule. He always thinks, okay, he'll finish the costumes in that time and the artwork in that time, and it always takes longer.
Yeah.
So we've always, especially at the end of the project, when the mastering and mixing and mastering is closing by, there's always panic. And I don't know if it's my fault, actually, because I've actually tried to lie to me about the deadlines so that we could, I mean, so that I would, we would get the stuff early enough, but right. It doesn't work. He knows. He knows that when I'm lying. and he called me, oh, I need another week, and we don't have, we can't do this in this time, and I'm like, oh my God, here we go again.
When Janne initially started working with LORDI, the band were skeptical of his involvement at first.
I play in a Finnish rock band, and we're our band, it's very, we've been playing for 35 years, and it's very like progressive arts kind of rock, right. And so they were, the, some of the guys were really hesitant about working with me because they thought that I'm gonna change LORDI. So, but no, of course not. It's their band, and I just work with them. It's not my band, so
yeah.
I like experimental things. So it's sometimes everybody else is against his idea, like the last Collection album. So it was really hard to to make everybody else understand the thing, but I was like, hey, yeah, that sounds great. That's because I mean the idea is so out of this, you know. So that, and I'm because I think that the only good Kiss album is The Elder, and so finally we got one Elder like LORDI song that I was really happy about.
Yeah,
it's a great song. Don't tell me that I think that Elder is the only good song. Well, he knows it doesn't matter.
Janne's close relationship with LORDI means that he has to be critical at certain points, and I asked him here how Mr. LORDI usually takes that feedback.
Well, he's such a nice guy that he always says that, yeah, he listens to me, but then he always does what he wants to do.
Right. You know?
Yeah. But he listens to, yeah, he does listen to, yeah. But he's, sometimes there's like, it's the same there as well. There's sometimes like, oh, there's a good chorus there. And he says that, oh, it's not that good. And I said, well, come on, it's pretty good. But then he's like, no, it's not that good. And it kind of, it's like a ball game in a way that we have to kick balls to each other, and then we see what's gonna happen, which is the goal.
We'll hear more from Janne in season 2 of this series, and the band that he is part of, that's that progressive alternative rock band that LORDI were a bit skeptical about being involved with him because of, was CMX, and you can hear them here. While LORDI were in the studio recording this album, they were approached with an idea and an opportunity. This opportunity was, of course, to enter the Eurovision Song Contest qualifiers and to represent Finland at the 2006 finals in Athens, Greece. But that's next time on the season 1 finale of Monsters of Rock, The LORDI Story. I'm Matthew Kessie, and Monsters of Rock, The LORDI Story is a True Metal podcast production. I'd like to thank LORDI, Eamon, KALMA, Awa, and Janne Halmkrona for their time, insights, and kindness to the show. And please head over to True Metal Podcast's Instagram page to see the photo library for this week's episode.